Matthew chapter 4, verse 1 says, "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil." And I'm going to go ahead and read verses 1 through 11. "And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, 'If you are the Son of God, command these stones become bread.' But he answered and said, 'It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God.' Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone.' Jesus said to him, 'It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God.' Again, the devil took him up on an exceeding high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory, and said to him, 'All these I will give if you will fall down and worship me.' And Jesus said to him, 'Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve.' Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him." All right, chapter 4, verse 1, "As he was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil." So as he went through the baptism, as he identified with us, as he began to make the way and began his public ministry, now he enters into this temptation. He was led up by the Holy Spirit of God. This wasn't something where he was wandering around and the devil was out looking for him. The Holy Spirit led him to this place. It was by the will of the Lord, and to a barren place. And in this process, he will also begin to not only overcome, be our forerunner, the one who makes a way, but he's also the spotless lamb, the one in whom no sin is found, the one who is tempted in all points, that he could be a faithful and compassionate high priest, but remain sinless. That we can come to him, that in the process of these temptations, that in the process of his life and ministry, there's not a point of the human experience that Jesus can't say, "Yeah, I know what you're going through. Yeah, I was tempted. That was brought against me. That was something that I had to overcome." And I love that about that. As you read, and I would encourage you even to reread Hebrews chapter 2 and Hebrews chapter 4, of just that amazing ministry that the Lord Jesus Christ becoming our high priest has stepped into for us, not just as our mediator, the one that can put his hand on man and his hand on God, but also the one that this week, no matter what you went through, you can go to. And he knows. That he knows. Not just simply that there's just this divine empathy that can be extended, but that he can give aid, that he can empower, that he can strengthen you. He overcame and he was victorious in it all. He didn't just do a little bit better than the best person. Jesus Christ went all the way. And we need a Savior, we need a high priest that can and does go all the way. Not only that he remains sinless, but that he has the power and the resources, the know-how, the can-do to help you. So as he goes through these things, a great many things will come out of it. And it seems in Mark and Luke that the temptations really kind of happen maybe over the whole time, the whole 40 days. But I believe that Matthew presents this in such a way that he really brings the force, the pinnacle of it all, at the end of the 40 days. when the times were the toughest, when his body was the weakest, the driest, that's when the enemy came to tempt him. When life was most difficult, that's when the hammer was dropped. But I find it, but I don't want to go too far on that, because we know, one, that Jesus was the Son of God, able to overcome. And so I'd like to, a couple definitions for the word tempt, as he's going to be tempted by the devil. The first definition for the word tempt, or to test, is it's to test or prove. The word prove simply means to demonstrate the truth or existence of something by evidence or argument. Number two, to demonstrate to be the specified thing by evidence or argument. So from heaven's perspective, from the Lord Jesus Christ, the test wasn't, a nail biter, whether or not he was going to sin. But it was to demonstrate, to give the evidence that he is who he says he is. This is the Son of God, the Savior of the world, come to save mankind, and I'm going to demonstrate to you that he is not overcome by evil. He will overcome it. He is the spotless one. He's going to be tested. He's going to be proven this to be so. To prove it, to demonstrate it. The second definition is what I believe also comes from the world, or the enemy's side, satanic side. To test or to tempt is to solicit to evil. We know that what someone can mean for evil, God can use for good. And those are really the two sides of the tests or the temptations in your life. If God allows it in your life, it is not for your destruction or for your evil or for your failure. Though the enemy may mean it for that. Though he may solicit you to evil, the Lord is not. Turn with me to James chapter 1. We'll read verses 12 through 17 as the Holy Spirit here gives some commentary on some of this. On temptations and trials. The book of James, beginning in verse 12. Says, blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. So we see there some of God's purposes in allowing this in your life, allowing this in the life of Christ. If the Holy Spirit's brought you to a place, maybe even a difficult place, maybe even a dry place, maybe there's a time in your life where things are just a little barren, unfruitful. And there's some temptation and things going on. God is working it out. God desires to work in you to give you the crown of life, to bring you through it. That if there's a weakness or something that is not of him in you, he wants to get that out because he wants to build your life. He wants to make you, as he conforms you to the image of his Son in such a way that when you are tested, you are displaying the great work that God has done in you. His work, his glory. The Father was glorified in Jesus walking through this. Every good gift is from him. In contrast, do you have the patience to allow God to have his work in you? And this is really what the enemy is going to really kind of throw out there at Jesus, using the natural desires and natural passions, the created God-given things within a person to get him to step out of the Father's will. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, it says, "Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you." We're going to see this test. And though Jesus is victorious, we would ask ourselves, do we have the trust in our Father? Do we have the humility to let him work it out? Do we have that? There's in March of 2007, there was a skywalk, a thing built over the top of the Grand Canyon, not over the top, but just extended out into the Grand Canyon. In the building of it, they used 1 million pounds of steel. They used 83,000 pounds of glass. They spent almost an entire year, because this is going to extend 70 feet out over the canyon, sitting approximately 4,000 feet above the canyon floor. And it's going to be glass, and you're going to walk out over there, and you're going to look 4,000 feet down, 70 feet out from the edge. So they spent about a year, and they were drilling in the rock and making sure that the foundation is well and good. Do you suppose when it was time to test the materials or even walk out and test that perhaps somebody said, "You first," that engineer or those people working on the project said, "Okay, let's test it because I want to see it fail." That would be crazy. Do we suppose less of the Lord that if he allows something into your life, that his purpose is for evil? No. His purpose is that we would succeed, that what he's building will endure, that what you're laboring in as you give your life to him will be something that is wonderful when it's done. So when this thing was done and finished, they estimated that it could hold 71 million pounds, which is approximately, they estimate, 71 fully loaded 747s that this thing could hold. They had tested every aspect of it, the foundation, the drills, the bolts, the materials, know how much this glass will hold and the metal will hold. Each one was tested and then assembled. So is in your life, as the Lord refines and tests and builds you into something, and to be a part of a body, into something that he wants to endure, to bless, to give the crown of life, something to be successful when it's all done. There are many tests, but as we're going to see, Jesus passed them all. Jesus passed them all. Verse 2. Now, when the tempter came to him, now when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterwards, he was hungry. I would say probably. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." So as the temptations here begin, 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, says, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." And we're going to see a progression through these, the desires of the flesh. So I don't know however many you guys have fasted or fasted often. I've never fasted 40 days. They say, you know, after 3 or 4 days, you begin to lose your hunger for a time. I have not found that to be true. I think I'm somewhere, I think I'm somewhere around the last time. It was about 8 days. And I think it's honestly because I have a supernatural hunger most of the time. And so it takes longer to get through. You know, it's an intense hunger. What can I say? We all have our crosses to bear, I suppose. No. Anyways, so after that initial time, that initial challenge, you know, your body kind of goes in fasting mode. It begins to process energy differently, and it's using the resources from your body, whether it be the fats or in eliminating different aspects of the toxins or different things in your body. It just goes through this long process. And they say somewhere out about 40 days, because your body has really exhausted most of its resources that it has on backup, and it begins to pull the muscle and the nutrients and things from your internal organs. Your body is, of course, feeding on itself, and now is feeding on the most important things, and you are about to pass away. And so you get this one last extremely strong hunger. Your body letting you know, hey, you better do something different or you will die. And so here we come to Jesus after 6 weeks of not eating. 6 weeks. You know, if it's today, he hasn't eaten since May. And in this dry and barren place, and this is when the enemy comes to him. And he says to him, but the idea there in the Greek is, since you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. You're a child of God. You are the only unique Son of God. Command these stones to become bread. You haven't eaten in 6 weeks, Jesus. Your body's going to die. How is this suffering? How is this going to be the will of God? Why don't you just take it into your own hands? Solve your problem. You have the resources. You have the ability. Why not do it? You know, and for me, I'd be, you know, looking around, you know, because Israel's full of rocks. That one does look a little bit like a donut hole. And that one looks like a cupcake. We can solve this real quick. It would, you know, praise the Lord, it was Jesus and not me, so. So this is when he comes to tempt him. Since you're the Son of God, if this is who you say you are, why not do that? But Jesus answered him with the word of God. He says, it is written, man. One good reminder that Jesus was experiencing this as a man. Philippians chapter 2 is very explicit that while never ceasing to be God, he became a servant. He truly became a man. He set aside his divine prerogatives for this purpose. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. What a hard thing. When Jesus has the power and ability to provide for it, to provide where the Father has not. You know, it took the time to read 1 Peter chapter 5:5-7 there. Because not to take, you know, that is one of the great conditions of the evils of man, is that all we like sheep have gone astray. We each one of us gone on our own way. We've taken it into our own hands. God, yes, you have your priorities and things that you're doing in my life, but I'm going to do my own thing. Jesus, you haven't eaten. Your body is wasting away. You have the ability to go ahead and take it in your hands. The Father hasn't provided for you. Do it. Or will you humble yourself and allow God to take care of it in his time? I'm just in awe of Jesus, the trust. You know, we have a small example in Abraham. Here he received the command of God, hey, I want you to go up and you're going to offer your son, your only son, the one that you love. And then as they were heading up the mountain and they were leaving, the servant said, you know, we'll be back. We're going to, the child and I, we're going to go up and we're going to worship, but we're going to come back. And Abraham didn't know how it was going to go with Isaac. He only knew that he was supposed to sacrifice him. And as they were heading up the hills, they're going there, you know, the son, Isaac, you know, Dad, where is the offering? Where's that where we're going to sacrifice? And Abraham, you know, God will provide himself the sacrifice, provide himself the lamb. But Abraham didn't know how it was going to go. All he got is the son he loves. I've got to go end his life. But so convinced and so trusting in his father, the one who promised, that he said, well, even if I slay him, well, I guess God will raise him back from the dead. And we have this amazing example of faith and trust in the word of God, that our life isn't dependent upon the food and the things and how we can provide for ourselves, but we are to trust in every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. If he said it, do we have the faith to wait for his provision in it? So many things in life, you know, Abraham had this amazing display of faith, and God said, man, righteous. That was his faith working itself out. Because he trusted and he believed me and he didn't withhold anything. And here's Jesus, the greater than Abraham. The resources and ability to provide for a need. He said, no, I'm going to trust my Father. I'll wait for his provision. I don't live by what I can provide. I live by what the Father provides. What I see him do, what I see him say, what he provides, that's what I do. And it's based upon the word of God. We live in a world that obeys passions of the body. That if we have that passion, if we have that desire, that becomes the will, the latest fad, the latest fashion, the whatever. Does it dictate what you do, or does God? We've been made with bodily passions that are of themselves a blessing. Things are wonderful to look at. There are things that are wonderful to hear. Food is a blessing. There are many of these blessings, but the enemy will use these to entice us to use them for evil, for our own will, and not for the Father's. And we have this coming against us continually in the world. Who will we trust? What will we use our body? What will we use our mind? What will we use our strength as an instrument of? For the Lord or for his adversary? For the adversary. It's a good question. You know, Lord, do I trust the Lord to bring me a spouse or put me in a relationship or to give me this thing? Or will I wait on his time? I could probably change the way I clothe. Clothe myself. I could probably go on to the whatever website. I could probably go out and make sure this need, this desire, this want is met. Or do I trust my Heavenly Father? Do I trust him with positions, things that he's given me in my life? Where am I at in life? What do I have in life? I should be farther by now, or is it all wasted? Or do I humble myself? And that, do I absolutely believe that if, as I cast my cares upon him, I humble myself, that he will exalt me in due time? Do I believe that he'll bring it about in his time? Jesus absolutely believed that. The Father said it. I'm going to trust in it. That sets the course of my life, not my passions, not my bodily needs, not whether or not it'll save my skin, but the Father, every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. There was a man dialoguing with the Lord once, and he was kind of a philosophical guy, talking about time. You know, Lord, you know, with you, 1,000 years is a day, 1,000 years, right? Yeah, you know, yeah, of course. Well, so, I mean, so similarly, I could say, you know, a 1,000,000 years is as a second. Sure, you could say that. Okay, well, how's that work? Does that work the same with resources? You know, you own the cattle on 1,000 hills. You own the whole earth. You know, it's all yours, right? Right. Mm-hmm. Right. So I could say, like, $1,000,000 is the same as a penny. That's right. It's either paper or metal. You know, it's just nothing. It's all the same to me. I can provide either. So the man said, so Lord, it's all the same. Could I have $1 million? Same. It's all the same as a penny. The Lord said, just a second. Do we trust our Heavenly Father to provide our need, or do we provide it for ourselves? And as we go through each one of these, maybe take the time now when we do communion this evening, however, to ask the question, Lord, how am I doing on this? How am I doing on this? Holy Spirit, may you teach me. Where have I taken it into my own control, provided for my own needs and not waited for you? Where have I looked to my own strength and not to the word of God, your promises and your provision? Verse 5, then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And Jesus said to him, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. So he answers him with the word of God. And you know, if you've been in your Bible or you've been walking with the Lord for a while, you know that Satan, he knows himself some scripture. He's not afraid to quote it, not afraid to go to church, not afraid to take something and twist it, to bend it. Since God cares for you, let's see what you'll do with this. And so he takes him up and takes him to Jerusalem and sets him on the pinnacle of the temple. And of course, as with most everything, there is some debate in scholars on how high this is. Josephus said it was around a couple hundred feet. Some have said it was higher, as it would look out over the Kidron Valley. I don't know. It was high enough to make a difference. That's my scholarly input. So now, as Jesus answered with the word, Satan is coming back and using scripture. And if you're going to use the word against the word of God, you're going to lose. But he's going to do it anyways. So he couldn't tempt the Son to provide for himself. He trusted in his Father. How about forcing the Father to provide for the Son? Why not force a supernatural event? Appeal to man's need for approval and public recognition. Isn't that why you're here? The enemy might be telling him. Aren't you wanting to be recognized? Aren't you wanting to... Isn't this a part of the angel's ministry here? This would really show, because at the time, many of the Jews expected the Messiah to kind of appear out of the sky and just to kind of descend down from the temple as he was making himself known. Isn't this your goal, Jesus? Let's just bring it out and let's do something amazing. Let's do a big miracle. A spectacular display. God doesn't need our spectacular displays. He will do them in his time. He doesn't need us to make a grand entrance, to make a name for ourselves. He will do that. There are a lot of people that over the years have tried to, really, I believe, have been tempted into this. I don't know their hearts, but it sure seems to be. There was a group that, after reading the end of Mark 16, because, you know, they will drink deadly poisons, and they'll take up dangerous snakes, that they decided to do it. There wound up being a lot of dead people, and some live, but don't tempt the Lord. You may have grand ideas. You may be doing it while clutching a promise in your hand, saying, well, I'm just going to do this because this will really glorify God, but it's all about you. Again, trusting the Lord. But let's look at the quotation here, as Satan quotes Psalm 91, verse 11 and 12. Let's go back and look at that. So as he's quoting this to Jesus, he quotes out of this psalm. I want to notice something. Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12. So here the psalmist writes, "For he shall give his angels charge over you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone." There's an important part that's missing from what he was sharing with Jesus. In all your ways. In all the Father's ways. In all the ways that he should act. What he should be. He leaves that out. Oh, don't worry. The angels, they have a charge over you and they're going to bear you up. Just leave, you know, leave what you're supposed to do out. Just go ahead and walk it out. And again, Jesus said, "It is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." It's the same attack as the garden. It's the same old with the enemy. As he came to Eve first saying, you know, and she first noted, well, that is good to eat. Wait, you know, maybe the Lord's holding something back from us. You know, that is desirable to make one wise. It is beautiful to look at, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Brings it here to him. Jesus said, "You shall not tempt the Lord your God." The Satan, same old thing. Did God really say that? Maybe I'll twist a little, maybe I'll add a little, maybe I'll subtract a little. And to get people to buy, well, that sounds mostly true, that sounds good. The master twister. But Jesus knowing and answers him again with the word of God. Just now, since you're the son. In verse 8, again the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." God's plans for you. Positions. Took him up on a high mountain. Now, I'm not sure, I couldn't see if it was completely, if there was anything to really go on, but Hallie's Bible Handbook had an interesting note on where Jesus was. He believed that, or speculated that he was actually where Elijah was fed by ravens, and that from where the temptation was taking place that you could actually see Mount Calvary. And so as the devil took him to an exceedingly high mountain, he offers him all the kingdoms of the world, all glory and no cross. No cross. You don't have to look at the cross. You don't have to be around there. You know, the Father says he's going to give you all the you're going to have all the nations. It's all going to be yours. But you don't have to go to the cross. I'll give it to you. That same idea that Peter tried to convey to Jesus. Oh, Lord, you don't have to go to the cross. Get behind me, Satan. I'll give you the glory. Just worship me. Let me take you to a grand place. Let me show you glory. I just want a little worship. Just a quick bow. Nothing big, just a little compromise. I just want a peace. Look at all that I can give you. Look what you don't have to go through. What has any of these people in the world ever done for you, Jesus? You're going to go suffer and die for them? Let me give you a better way. Let me give you an easier way. I'll give it to you now. And that's so our society. That's what we're being constantly tempted with. You don't need to take up your cross and deny yourself. Let me take you up on a a big hill. Let me show you the glory. Just bring this compromise into your life. You can have it now. You don't need to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and wait for Him to exalt you. Take it now. And so tempting, is it? But Jesus Christ conquered. He prevailed. He prevailed. And it's so interesting. I guess sad, pathetic. I don't know how you would categorize it. But that after all this time, Satan would trade these kingdoms, their glory, all of this for worship. In Isaiah, we saw that when pride entered him, he wanted to be like the Most High God. He wanted to be worshipped. And yet all that he would do, and over the millenniums, he would still trade it all for that. Because of pride. Feeding his pride. It's never full. The same old doctrine of wanting to deceive people into worshiping the creation rather than the creator. All the nations are already promised to the Son. The glory. So that's something interesting to keep in mind, though we are to be good citizens. We are called to speak truth and to stand for righteousness. But let us never forget that the glory of what glory he's offering of the nations applies to ours as well. Ours is not the only nation that will come through the millennium and say, well, all the other ones were evil, but this one, whoo, that's a keeper. And it's hard because we have everything that we're called to be as citizens, and we want to see a nation that's built on righteousness and the foundations and the biblical principles, but never forgetting at the end of the day, they're under the sway of the wicked one. That he is described as the God of this world. Now, God reigns over it all, but there is something about the glory of them, of the nations, that he can offer, that he possesses. But Jesus will one day bring them right again. Something interesting to ponder as you walk forward, as we want to stand for righteousness, but not let it deter us from honoring and loving Jesus Christ, because this isn't our home. So he appeals to the passion, the possessions, the position, the glory. And when something was contrary to the word of God, what do you do? Martin Luther said about temptations, you can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can keep it from nesting in your hair. We can't stop the enemy from coming and testing us in our life, and sometimes the most difficult places, but we can keep him from nesting in our hair. Because Jesus faced these things and conquered them as the Son of Man. And he has the tools and resources for you to do so also. First, he was a spirit-filled man. And if you've been getting beat up or you're struggling with that today, ask the Lord for a fresh filling of his Holy Spirit. Keep being filled with the Spirit of God. Galatians 5:16 says, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. That's what he said. Won't happen. Being in the Word of God. And it's interesting to me that don't be intimidated by the enemy or whatever. Be in the Word of God. Jesus didn't quote from cover to cover. He quotes from a couple chapters in Deuteronomy. You can do that. You could read that. That's no problem. You can do that. As the Spirit fills you and the Word fills you, these are the tools and the strength that he walked in. And he has provided them for you as well. But one thing to be noticed also, I think out of this, and this was probably the most impactful for me, that I would share with you is the power was not in the quoting of the verses, in the knowledge per se of the verses. The power that Jesus Christ walked in, the power that his followers are to walk in the Spirit, is in obedience. The end of Hebrews chapter 5, as we learn that obedience, we walk in that, we have the ability to discern good and evil by reason of use. The power was in the obedience, not that he knew that every man should live by the words that proceed from the mouth of God, but that he believed it, he lived it, he obeyed it. He obeyed that he wasn't going to tempt the Lord his God. He obeyed that he was going to worship the Lord only and serve him only. It wasn't just that he knew the verses. Pharisees, lots of people know verses. He said, this is the preeminence that my Father has in my life. That his words, and I live by them, they are my life. Not what I can provide, not where I can go or who I can be or what grand thing will occur in my life, but my Father and what he says, his direction, that is my life. And I'm going to love him with all my heart, soul, strength, and mind, everything that I've got. The word of God, we need to obey it, to live it, to let it get in. Worship. As you worship and obey, that is drawing near, and the enemy will flee. And so as we look at these temptations, as Jesus, now baptized, beginning his ministry, and as we see the temptation stepped out, we would say, welcome to ministry. May face some challenges. It's going to happen. But in the word of God and his strength, you can overcome. What is it that overcomes the world? Our faith. It is the proof, the test, the evidence of that which is not seen. So Satan came for him and us. And he will come at force, full force in an opportune time. But we can overcome and we can worship. We can be filled with the Spirit and we can walk in obedience to God's word. Verse 11. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. So he worships the Lord, he draws near, and the enemy flees as he obeys the word of God, being filled with the Spirit of God. And here's one that I also would like you to consider this morning, is that Jesus Christ was ministered to. And it says specifically here by angels. What are angels, one of the angels' major functions, ministries? What do they do? To who? Us, to those who will inherit salvation. Hebrews chapter 1, they're ministering spirits. Hebrews goes on to say it's to those who inherit salvation. Gives aid. The gift of encouragement. God gives that. For you and I. Mercy, giving, a church. If you've been in this dry and barren place and you have been struggling and you've been tempted to take matters into your own hands, or maybe even been beat up and maybe you even failed, if Jesus can be ministered to, needed to be ministered to, so do you. Will you let him? Will you submit to the Spirit of God? Will you humble yourself and receive grace? Pride resists, will get you no grace, but humbling yourself will get you grace. And we don't know how they ministered to him and what. Some speculate angel food cake. Maybe manna. Manna cake, manna pie, manna cotti. Maybe a little, with a little manatee. I don't know. We'll see. Jesus was ministered to. We need it as well. We are created with needs. Primarily, we need to be with him. And he has resources to build up and strengthen you through these processes. He was the one at every point who was tempted, as we are, but yet without sin. He has the resources and the strength. He didn't just go a little further, he went all the way. And he has the strength and the resources to bring you through too, as well. He's able to aid those who are tempted. And yet he also was ministered to, and I pray that you will be this morning. And let the Lord do that to you. So as we're going to take communion this morning, I want to invite the worship team to come back up. But as they do, I want to share a story. It was one that Billy Sunday used to share. It was one that he was told by a Christian in Iowa. Major Whittle, who was the leader of a militia and commander of a firing squad, at the time of the Civil War, there was a band of organized outlaws in the Midwest called the Quintrell's Raiders. They would sweep down and come upon unsuspecting communities on the frontier and rob them, pillage them, burn, and then they would ride away before help would come. The situation became so desperate that in Kansas, they formed a militia to search them out. They had orders to execute without delay any rioters who were found. Not long afterward, a group of these men were captured in Iowa. A long trench was dug behind them as they were lined up in a line. Their hands and legs were tied and their eyes were covered. And as the firing squad was forming to execute these men, suddenly a young man rushed out from under the brush, crying out, "Wait, wait." With the guns pointed at him, he said, "Let this one particular man go free. He has a wife and babies, and he's needed at home. Let me take his place. I'm guilty." It was an extraordinary appeal, but the stranger insisted that he not be denied, and after a long consultation, the officers granted the request, released the condemned man, and the volunteer was put in his place and was killed. The freedman later gave the gentleman who had died in his place, Willie Lee, a proper burial. And on his tombstone it read, "Sacred to the memory of Willie Lee, he took my place in line and died for me." Sacred to Jesus Christ, Billy Sunday would say, who took our place on the cross and died for me.